Well, it is always a great pleasure to be here to meet the President of the Academy. It's a great pleasure to see the Italian Ambassador and to greet also all the people here present which have participated in the development of science in Yevolosha. Also the director of the physics department, which will host the first Ethernet center in Minsk. We have made in the last years a celebration in Minsk of an exceptional man who all of you know. Jakub Borisovich Zetovich. He was born in Minsk and he developed with Sakharov much of the work of nuclear physics on which many of you in this room have been working in the last years. But Zetovich was also exceptional for us because after the first part of his violent and successful work on nuclear physics, he decided to bring his attention to the sky and to the universe. And 50 years ago, I had the pleasure to meet him for the first time in Moscow. And it is very interesting also the way later on our relation developed. And the last time I met him in Moscow, he told me, look, come downstairs, I will show you a present I received from my friend in Minsk. And I did not expect, we went down one floor and there was a bronze statue of Jakub Borisovich Zetovich. And in Italian, una faccia di bronzo means something special. And I told him, look, Jakub, it's the first time I meet somebody with the bronze face, which you. It's a pleasure always to see, just outside this building, the statue, that statue of Zetovich. And in this spirit, I bring you the message for nuclear physics, which involves so many fundamental knowledge, but also very big problem in our planet Earth, and very much of the development of and defense of the development for nuclear physics will take place on the planet Earth, but follow Zetovich for the second part of his activity to the sky, to the activity of the physics of the neutron star, supernova, neutron star, black holes, and GRBs. These are the four pillars which have been developing. And I would like just to make sure with you that we understand what we mean by each one of these four pillars. The supernova. The first example, which is really the most impressive observation ever made by humankind, has been the discovery of the first supernova recorded by the Chinese, the Japanese, the Korean astronomer in 1054. This object has been expanding since and observed first by naked eye by the Chinese, the Korean, in the moment of explosion. This is the most recent picture taken of this object still expanding today at 300 kilometers per second by the Hubble Space Telescope. A beautiful image. This is a supernova. And we are learning very much about this fantastic system, about the energy of this system, as a fundamental building block of relativistic astrophysics. The second topic, of course, in this process of understanding, they have been the founding fathers of physics. In 1916, Albert Einstein introducing general and special relativity. In 1922, Fermi introducing Fermi statistics with Dirac. And in 1927, Werner Heisenberg developing the idea of Einstein, developing the work of Federico Fermi, reached the first understanding of the possibility in very strong electromagnetic field to more polarize the vacuum. And out of the vacuum, matter, antimatter, the electron, positron, pair. And this, exactly this physics, I will try to explain to you, developed by Heisenberg, is the one which we are observing in the sky. Thanks to the work of Einstein today, we observe in the sky a black hole. Thanks to the work of Fermi, we understand, thanks to Fermi-Dirac statistics, a neutron star. Thanks to Heisenberg, we can understand electron-positron plasma and explosion of gamma ray bursts. The first example, of a neutron star happened 50 years ago, 49 years ago. Next year, we will celebrate 50 years of this great discovery. This picture shows the remnant of the supernova, and in the center you see these two stars. And these pictures on the right are a millisecond apart. And as you see, there are 33 milliseconds, you see one of the stars to turn on and off. This was the clear evidence that in the center of the supernova there was a neutron star. This was the starting of relativistic astrophysics. It was a shock all over the planet, promoted by the English observation of the pulsar, the first neutron star. And in Princeton, there was Johnny Wheeler, here represented with Albert Einstein and with Hideki Yukawa, which in 1968 he received me in Princeton, worked me. In Princeton, we were a small group. There were three groups in the planet. Now there are thousands of people, or 10,000 of people working in relativistic astrophysics. But at that time, there were only three small groups. One around John Wheeler, and here I am at the center without Birbir, and looking at Johnny Wheeler smiling, and on the back, one of the greatest Italian mathematicians, Tullio Regge. And and then the other group was the one around Zedovich in Moscow. And the third group, smaller but very influential, around, not around a leading person like Wheeler in Princeton or Zedovich in Russia, but a group of self-made young people, including Stephen Hawking, Martin Rees, and a few others, which were working around in England, in Cambridge. Wheeler gave a message, don't study neutron stars, go on, because everybody will work about the neutron star. And we went one step further in introducing what you call Chorny, yes, black holes. And it was quite already translating the word black hole was not trivial, because the Russian called this object frozen star, because of time stopped in the developing of the singularity, the horizon of the black hole. And therefore, we had to convince them to change the name more attractive of black holes invented by John Wheeler and myself. The translation was not trivial. The French refused to call Black Trou Noir. They said it was obscene. And then later on, they accepted us. And now when I see on Le Monde, Le Trou Noir de l'économie, I smile how long many years we had to wait for them to translate into French, Black Horse and Trou Noir. They refused. They wanted to call Astro Club. But also the Russian adopted, and what is more important is that we gave the formula of the black hole with Dimitris Christodoulou and the Hubble satellite launched by Riccardo Giacconi prove the existence both of neutron star and how you see a neutron star. You see a neutron star in a binary system in which you have an ordinary star evolving and transferring the matter into the neutron star, and from the binary period and the pulsation, you can know about the rotation of the neutron star, not isolated like the supernova, but in a binary system. And more important still, you could have a big star of the order of 20 solar masses accreting into a signal sexual into a very large black hole. Okay, these were important steps recognized by at the time and also recognized by Riccardo Giacconi, to Riccardo Giacconi by his Nobel Prize when finally the work of Uhuru and the binary system having a neutron star companion and the main star were officially recognized. But there has been also another Nobel Prize, not for the case of a normal star with a neutron star, but two neutron stars together. The emission of gravitational waves by Ulse and Taylor, also at Princeton University. And this was another epochal moment of the progress of general relativity, to have identified supernova, to have identified neutron star, to have seen black hole, and to have seen neutron star in binary system emitting gravitational wave. Italy is famous to organize the Varenna schools, and in this Varenna school we celebrate Nobel Prize winner the discovery of neutron star and black holes. But I want to move now to a next field, to one which has characterized the physics in the last 30 or 40 years. And paradoxically, also this discovery is related to Zeldovich. And it's a paradox where great physicists can make a great contribution to astrophysics even if they don't do physics, but they do strange things. And Zeldovich was a person which was maybe was not only extremely genius, but unpredictable. And one of the unpredictable things Zeldovich did was just after the time in which US was trying to reach the moon with the astronaut to prove that Russia could, Soviet Union, excuse me, reach the moon first. And Zeldovich, having contributed to the rocket and to the bombs, he proposed to have a nuclear bomb explode on the moon and have everybody looking at a given time for the nuclear bomb explosion on the moon to show the primacy of the Soviet space and the nuclear physics project. Of course, as you know, this project was discovered with terror by everybody, and was not followed, fortunately. But the idea that somebody could have such an idea, tackled, and immediately, a few years later, the US put into orbit the Vela satellite in order to make absolutely sure that since there was an international agreement of no proliferation of nuclear bomb, that nobody would dare to explode H-bomb either on the Earth or on the Moon or in the polar orbit. And the former Vela satellite was sent down. These satellites were peculiar. They had an atomic clock on board. They were a set of two sets of four, and they were able to detect explosion coming either from the Earth or from the Moon, and from the time of arrival of the signal in this satellite, it would have been possible to locate the place of explosion. The reason of this satellite were not oriented in a special place, they were omnidirectional, and the position were just the triangulation in three of these satellites. And what happens is that, as you see here from the right, is that as soon as the satellite were into orbit, it happened that they start to see an explosion, three satellites, with a characteristic time of the order of seconds, and very, 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 very similar in intensity to a nuclear bomb on Earth or on the Moon. But they were exploding, they were registering almost every few days, and there was no evidence for nuclear bombs, neither on the Earth nor on the Moon. And then the big question is, where did this signal come from? And the fantastic story is that through the work of, well, there has been a special moment. Thibaut d'Amour and myself said, oh, these are not the nuclear bombs on the Earth or on the Moon. There is the formation of the black hole somewhere in the universe, which we see as the gamma ray burst. Fortunately, we published this. But the prediction was incredible, which we had the idea to propose, that there was the formation of the black hole, but not local. But if we take into account that they had to be cosmological, then the result is that there should be much, much more energetic than a nuclear bomb. And we predicted 10 to the 54 Earth. This number was too big. This was the theory from the theory of Einstein of the Kern black hole, and the vacuum polarization of Heisenberg, and an energy of 10 to the 54 Earth. But what it means 10 to the 54? As you all know, the energy of the Sun is 2 10 to the 33 Earth. If you take all the stars in the galaxy, 10 to the 33 times 10 to the 10 to the 12 gives you 10 to the 45. We are still short of 10 to the 54. The rest 10 to the 9 means all the luminosity, all the energy emitted by all the stars in a galaxy of 100 billion stars and in the billion of galaxies outside in the universe. Therefore, I propose that these objects, which appear to be à cette boucle allemande qui, de, en Europe, was really equivalent to the energy of the, all the stars in the universe in that signal. This was a proposal out of first principle. Bit by bit, I want to show you now, without bothering you, the latest development that this has been, we have been able to prove. The first step were long, and due to the great development of technology, and I hope very much that this technology, initially developed mainly in the United States with the Uhuru, then with the GRO gamma ray burst in US, has further developed in a sequence of new telescopes, and with the participation now of all the countries of the world. Initially, US with the quantum satellite, this huge quantum satellite with 32 meters, with the detector here of gamma rays, which showed the first step that this object were distributed all over the universe without any preference in galaxy, but they distributed homogeneously. These were the first telescope. And then there has been an incredibly lucky telescope sent up by Italy and by Netherlands. Actually, there has been a lot of problem with this telescope. It was supposed to be 50-50 between Italy and Netherlands. I was president of the scientific committee of ASA at the time, and on my desk there was this proposal, 50-50, for 50 billion lire, 25-25, at least 250 for Italy, 25 for the Netherlands. And then it kept increasing, and then the Netherlands had no more money. Therefore, we decided to go on as a bold decision of the scientific committee of ASI, and this satellite was finally sent into orbit. This satellite initially had problems even about the gyroscope, and on. And we were very concerned, but finally, this satellite, which was for the first time unifying the X-ray astronomy of the US and the gamma ray astronomy also from US, but bringing them together in the same satellite allowed to make the greatest discovery ever for the gamma ray burst, namely the fact that there was an afterglow which allowed the localization of the object in the X-ray and gamma rays in the sky. First the Vega, the discovery, then the location in the sky of contact, and then the Betosax satellite allowed for the first time the position, clear position of the object, and as soon as the position was localized in X and gamma rays, it was possible to transmit that position to the ground, to the optical telescope in Mauna Kea, to the VLT developed in the meantime by ESO in Chile, and it was possible to localize this object at 10 billion light years away from the Earth, and realize that the energy emitted by a gamma ray burst was exactly 10 to the 54 Earth, as predicted in our paper just after the discovery of gamma ray burst. This, I would like maybe to spend a second to indicate to the Italian ambassador why these two family of satellites were needed. The space satellite received the X radiation and the gamma radiation, the high energy radiation, which evidenced the existence of a burst. But it's not possible to localize, they have no resolution to understand from which star the radiation comes from. In order to localize the star, you need optical telescope which have much bigger resolution and identify precisely the source with an optical telescope. And it was fantastic that while Europe and US were developing the satellite to do this observation, still Europe and US were fantastically lucky at the same time to develop the optical telescope in Mauna Kea and BLT in Chile. And the coincidence of a signal made possible the optical identification. And the optical identification from the, technically speaking, from the red shift of the light is possible to find the distance. And the distance 10 billion light years away. This has been a fantastic story of which I will have to find the time to write in a book popular in the next days. But let's go to the further development, to the recent development. Therefore, just this picture explains you a little bit the novelty of a gamma ray burst. You see, here this blue line indicates the real time, and the blue line indicates the 5 billion years of the life of our planetary system. The Sun and the planetary system, 5 billion years, we are here. And here is the light curve, the trajectory in time of our solar system. These sources are much earlier. Here is the Big Bang of the universe, and signal come from billions of light years away, namely they originate of the order of 10 billion years before the observation, at the time in which the solar system was not yet born. But we follow this signal, and through all the universe, and explore, therefore, the universe for the first time in its fantastic new physics. And now we have the GRB, we have the supernova, we have the black hole, and lately what has been happening is that there was a coincidence between a supernova and the GRB, and this has promoted a completely new understanding which I just want to outline shortly. The general idea is that I will give you a very quick summary of this development, which will show you the extraordinary fact that we can reconstruct in a single event, we can reconstruct the evolution of star, binary nature, the formation of a black hole, the emission of the supernova at the same moment of space and time. The more massive star, like Eta Carinae, which is represented here, are roughly 100 solar masses, and this 100 solar mass binary evolve evolve slowly in the thermonuclear revolution. The more massive stars evolve faster. Therefore, if you have a very big star of the order of 100 solar masses, like Eta Carinae, it evolves, the more massive star evolves and forms a neutron star. And the second star evolves, the less massive one, evolves slower. And you have a binary system similar to the one that Riccardo Giacconi had discovered inside our own galaxy. But the scenario which we have introduced in order to try to explain why you can have a GRB and a supernova coalescing and exploding at the same time from the same place in space implies a new understanding of the physical process. A new evolution in which two very, very massive stars evolve, the more massive one evolve first, and the second massive star still evolve in due time. And then this one forms a neutron star, and later this second star starts to evolve and become a red giant and expand. And in this case, you have transfer of matter from this star into the neutron star. And then later on, also this neutron star evolves, also this companion star evolves and forms a supernova. And what you have, therefore, is a binary system starting from two very massive stars in which one of the stars evolves first and forms a neutron star. The second star evolves smoothly and later and forms a supernova. And then you have this fantastic new system, which we have studied in Internet, which is the accretion from a supernova into the neutron star and the formation in real time of a black hole. And this is the physics that we are exploring during these days. Namely, we are following, for the first time, a completely new situation. While the screen is trying to find the right picture, let's spend this time to introduce you this new concept. This also was a concept which was introduced by Zeldovich in 1972 and independently by Wilson and myself. If you have, this is relatively simple to at least qualitatively understand. If you have a supernova exploding with a binary neutron star nearby, what you have is that this material transfer into the neutron star, these are the details which we developed in this theory, and accretes in the neutron star due to the neutrino emission which allows this process to occur. And you have the transfer from a supernova into a neutron star of intercritical accretion. What means intercritical accretion? You transfer one solar mass per second from the supernova into the neutron star. Therefore, in a few seconds, the neutron star becomes so massive that undergoes the gravitational collapse and forms a black hole. Well, it took some 10 years to develop this idea. And it took 12 million particles to simulate this phenomena by Laura De Cerda, one of our students in Icarus. I'm going to show you at least the qualitative beauty of this result. In red, you have the supernova exploding, and here the dark point is the neutron star. And the system is a binary which is represented by this simulation. Therefore, here you have the supernova exploding, which normally will be spherically symmetric, like the one in the car. And in this case, it's as a companion neutron star. Therefore, the matter of the supernova gets funneled into the neutron star, and here is the neutron star created by the supernova, the neutron star. And here you have the object, the neutron star accreting a solar mass a second with this hypercritical accretion introduced initially by Zeldovich many years ago. And what you see finally is when the neutron star reaches the critical mass, you see the formation of the black hole. The idea is new, it's totally new, in the sense that traditionally astronomers have been looking at the sky to a supernova or to a single object, and the object is always the same, no matter about the time evolution or periodicity, but the system stays there for a long time. Instead, in this case of this finally driven hypernova, you have a supernova here, a neutron star here, interacting together and forming a new neutron star black hole in 100 seconds. This is a new kind of physics. It's a new kind of astronomy. It's a new kind of astronomy which is similar to what has been observed in particle physics. We have heard that your group has participated in CERN in the accelerator of DESY, where the electron positron interact together to create new plus new minus. And this phenomena of electron and positron going to a new physical system occur in a very, very short time. Well, for the first time, this many-body interaction which, in which the particle physicists are acquainted, it happens also in astrophysics. It keeps longer, of the order of 100 seconds, but still very short with respect to the order time evolution. And you have a neutron star and a supernova creating in real time a new neutron star and a black hole. Of course, like in the case of particle physics, you need a big accelerator and technology to make the observation very accurate. And the development of this technology to make this measurement has been creating the greatest progress in human technology for everyday life. Similarly, the space technology needed to follow a merging of a neutron star with a supernova, it promotes the development of space technology and optical technology on the ground. But the situation is still more fascinating and still going on and on. And this is the situation which we are facing today, in which data can evolve in this direction to the formation of a black hole. In this other direction, it moves to the direction of the black hole and neutron star. And from this is the origin of binary neutron stars like the one discovered by Hulse and Taylor in our galaxy. This is the situation, this is practically new. Yesterday we did this, but the situation is much richer. It's a new universe which we are exploring. Formation of neutron star black holes in real time, which we observe in gamma ray bursts. And very likely, there are still things that can be very relevant. What is the, maybe I will come back to this at the end, in the conclusion. But let me tell you, there is even, in addition to the space technology, in addition to the ground technology in the optical, There is another avenue today, which we started long ago with Edoardo Amaldi, the study of gravitational waves. Well, they were very, very important results, which we did with our Brazilian colleague Jaime Chiorno. It took a long time to develop all these ideas, but today I am the signal which can come back from two black hole merging. Now, today there are instruments like the LIGO in Louisiana and Hanford and Virgo in Cascina that they purport to have measured the merging and the gravitational wave emitted by two black hole merging. The universe is completely different. Of course, I'm very happy about this result because we predicted all this work back in 72. But like sometime some Italian mathematician said, I am not against the new, but I am conservative. Therefore, I want to make sure that this coincidence and discovery of this additional signal, not only a gamma ray burst, but also about black hole merging and emitting gravitational waves, be tested and correct. But there are other scenarios coming in. Therefore, the only point I want to make is that general relativity has become, for initially, it was just a mathematical theory for the first 50 years. And it has become more and more and more accurate, and there is evidence that it can describe even the most precise verification with the development of neutron star black holes all over the universe. He said, the human being, the human society, which is able to develop this technology, will be the first one to take advantage of our progress of Homo sapiens in the understanding of the entire universe. But two things before closing, which I showed you before. What is the relevance of gamma ray burst for our life? Why the universe needs gamma ray burst? And this has a dramatic actuality today in Minsk, when people are celebrating the accident of the nuclear reactor Chernobyl. That is the terrible part of the story. The good part of the story is that the radiation is needed in changing the DNA. And I think it's fantastic that, don't misunderstand me when I mean fantastic, but I think that the Chernobyl case offers a laboratory to understand in details the interaction with the DNA. In a certain sense, the gamma ray bursts are now clear that is the location in which the plutonium and the uranium were first created. This is the fantastic connection between astrophysics and fundamental physics. And without the radiation of the GRB, we will not have Homo sapiens. DNA will not have evolved. Radiation is essential in creating the mutation of the species and the evolution of the species. We would not have Homo sapiens sitting and thinking if there were no gamma ray bursts to modify the DNA in the previous history of life in our universe. And the fact that gamma ray bursts are all over the universe is that this fecundation of radiation takes place all over the universe, and life necessarily is all over the universe. This is the other thing I would like to say about the situation today with the Italian Einstein, Heisenberg and Fermi allowed to concentrate the understanding of relativistic astrophysics, but now relativistic astrophysics is used in the universe in checking the fundamentals of the Einstein and fundamental physics. And this is the beautiful picture of John Wheeler in the Icanet Center in Rome. He drew this image of the universe, and thanks to the human eye, the universe taking conscience of the become aware of the universe and with the scientific understanding of the universe itself. And let's cheer up also on the role of Einstein. Mr. Ambassador, I presume that you can appear with your car and with the GPS maybe. Never forget when you use the GPS that without the accuracy of the satellite, which have allowed the identification of gamma ray bursts with such a precision, and the development also of Einstein equation, you could never have found the accuracy of 20 centimeters that are needed in identifying one place instead of the other. And again, that is a useful thing to realize, that fundamental science not only allows us to understand our place in the universe much more profoundly, for the positive and the negative, we have to be careful about nuclear physics, but we have also greater opportunity to understand where this very heavy element were formed. It's a new dimension. If a human man, and I want to quote your vision following the knowledge, don't consider just an intellectual adventure to look at the universe, but the technology developed is the one which makes a profound difference for the quality of life in our everyday life. I'm serious, both about the GPS, but also in being a human being which can understand with the Wheeler picture, the role of the man in the universe. This opened another question still. What is the mass the distribution of mass inside our galaxy? What is clear today, and that is becoming more and more evident, that only 10% of the mass is formed in the galaxy out of baryon, proton, neutron, electrons, and particle physics, which we know. The majority of mass is still not known, and it is represented by what we consider now the dark matter. And this dark matter is actually studied very actively by our scientists. Some of them will be here in the next day, and we have Gregory, of course, here, Shagin, and Kwatai Boshayev from who's working on this topic about the galactic structure in our group in Almaty, Kazakhstan, and there are other aspects which were studied by our colleague in Moscow. But the dark matter is the real big unknown. But there is now some of that dark matter, but a small part could be represented into black holes. Now, the point is, the black hole could be formed either by baryon or by dark matter. I mean, you have usual matter, baryons, dark matter, and then you have black holes, which could be formed both by dark matter and by normal matter. We believe that at the center of the galaxy, not our galaxy, but other galaxy, where you have black holes very big, of 10 to the 8, 10 to the 9 solar masses, very likely are formed by dark matter collapse. The small black hole, the one like Sirius X1, certainly they are formed by baryon.
Thank you very much for your answer. And you answered me the second question. My second question was, maybe considered black holes as some part fraction of the dark matter. Thank you very much for your
answer. The center of galaxy, very likely, the collapse has not occurred in baryons, but also occurred in Enos. We think around 50 keV particle is the things we are researching with the group, especially in Pescara and in South America.
I was very happy to listen to your reaction here, Professor. I wish you all the best in your science.
How many of you have met Zedovich? You have. Where did you meet him? Yes. Yes. Well, let's plan before the day after tomorrow to bring to this great man for this stage created by, he said, my friend, look what my friend in Minsk did to me. Yes. Let me show you the stage. Maybe we will bring a small flower to his monument. And keep thinking, we have published two books about the, thanks to Sergei and to Gregory, about Minsk and Zedovich. Take occasion to look back, because it's a great motivation how to move forward. to see the great experience and the vision of these great people in the past to guide us in the future. Well, when we wrote the book with Martin Rees and Wheeler, we made an introduction. And in that introduction, we quote Maxwell and other great physicists that they thought after the great discovery they had made of electrodynamics, everything which will be left for physics is just to go on in making a more precise measurement of the constant that they have involved. And this was the next goal. What is fantastic is that the nature is not predictable. And it is true. But it's much more exciting because you will not motivate any one of these people, very brilliant, to just work to the increase of details. If we were really in a universe door, the point is that at each progress in sensitivity in space technology or in nuclear physics or others, a new object has come out, a new understanding has come out, and we don't understand yet the structure of all this together, because from understanding all these things together, there are still many exciting other things which have to be discovered. Why the universe is matter, antimatter difference? Why the horizon is a big problem? I think there are great discoveries still to be done. Therefore, not only I fully agree with you that we need improvement, but we need improvement because far ahead there are big discoveries. Now, the other point which is essential and in which we can have a role, I was in favor even of inserting the promotion to commercialization, because the progress in technology, which is now necessary international, the effort cannot be done locally. Even a great local discovery cannot be recognized if it's not inserted in an international effort. This is another point. You were mentioning how international scientists were interested in local discovery. Yes, but this is the driving to make sure that the local excellence can be brought to international attention. Therefore, the gaze water is interesting, is why life is so interesting, and science is so interesting. It's prolific, it's rich. It's unpredictable a priori, but every time we make a further step, there is big new discovery coming in, which are very exciting, and allowing also the development of having a GPS to be able to find the house of one person from the other with great distinction, not to mix the wife with the